Good morning and welcome. Maybe today's session will possibly go a little longer because of a few reasons. Last night, Naushin spoke to me and I said there are some topics which have not been covered adequately, so I will try and do that. There are also some questions which have come from yesterday's session, some directly related, some not so related, but I want to discuss those questions first. The first question in terms of, has India dealt with adequately with the COVID crisis? The answer is, what is it that we're looking at? If you're looking at in terms of using the lockdown to ensure that the spread was arrested, maybe to some extent it was good at a national level across situations that possibly arrested the spread one. Second, the problem with that was not enough time was given for a lot of people to get home or to move there where they could be comfortable. That is a second issue. Third is in terms of we didn't anticipate how long it will take and what are the consequences will be on the poor. That is something which I want to discuss. So for that, we didn't think through that. What are the kind of assistance they would need and what will be the real context of their suffering. That is something which I don't think we really anticipate or understood. And the last, in terms of we didn't really adequately prepare our health infrastructure to meet the demand. A lot of the current facilities which are there have possibly come in the last 2 weeks in terms of additional facilities. If that could have been done from February, maybe situation would have been different because a lot of people in places like Mumbai and Delhi often died because their ambulances took time or they could not be admitted. Some took 3 or 4 days, people were sent back. So there were a lot of these issues which I think was something which could have been dealt with. The second question is in terms of what are the kind of responses which would be good. So in terms of wearing masks, okay. Personally, for a long time, I had issues in terms of virus, in terms of its size, could go through any kind of fabric. So wearing a mask will really help, but if it is blocking your saliva and other things which you release the thing into the air, maybe it's a good idea. So therefore, we'll need to really look at understanding this context in terms of using of masks. Physical distancing, I think, is definitely useful. How we manage, regulate, teach, all of that will be something which could have been done better, but I think it's useful. Third, in terms of what are the solutions? In terms of various kinds of medicines could possibly deal with it. I'm sure some of you have read in the newspapers about Glenmark releasing, having got permission to sell a drug. And also in terms of, it was believed maybe Glenmark developed it. This morning I've sent some three messages from Nauman Qureshi, who works for healthcare, who said that we just got permission because these drugs were available elsewhere, but they've not given permission for because it's a generic drug. And therefore being, and there are a lot of such drugs, other companies were also, Glenmark would release. Glenmark became the first in India to release it. Therefore, a better understanding of when you consume news, to understand that would be helpful. So therefore, that is one part in terms of, is our preparation really in terms of... Then there's a question about in terms of, isn't consuming local produce better than being vegan. Now, when you're talking about various kinds of nutrition options and choices we make, there is a context, history, and there's an understanding. So when you talk about vegan, it is something which talks about in terms of less impactful on the environment, and also in terms of there are a lot of people who have or lactose intolerant, so suggest that milk products are something which possibly are not good for us. But in terms of when we look at some of these evidence, the evidence can be mixed because studies, there are conflicting studies on both ways. But in places like the US and Europe, veganism is growing very, very fast. Also because of the kind of food production which exists. So if you look at especially Europe and America, this whole factory production of meat by injecting hormones, increasing volumes, has also affected health. So if you look at Europe especially, because of the steroids which are used to grow animals and various kinds of livestock, has seen a lot of young people, especially girls, attain puberty much earlier, especially in places like Denmark and Holland. The steroids in the blood have actually increased their height, because these are steroids which are inducing growth. So, and if you look at the kind of meat production in the US, they've been clearing forests and other things to produce meat in terms of the kind of energy that is used. So that is something which is definitely relevant. Now the question is, yes, you'll have to make your own choices depending on what you read and what makes sense to you. When we talk about this whole idea of local produce, as I said, food consumption and production has a lot of its own path and history that we need to understand. So when you talk about consumption of protein, where will the poor people get their source of protein? On Friday, I had gone to a village called Tara, and this person called Hiraji, who works in the Subhari Center, I went to his house, and his wife gave us food. It was the rice chapati, and they gave us a fish called Malya. It's a fish which comes from the sea through Patal Ganga River and comes into the rice paddy fields, because as monsoons come, to lay the eggs. And after that, they either go back, and a lot of them die on the way back to the sea. They are marine fish rich, and they are very small fish. So local Adivasis and the local community in monsoon find this an extremely good and extremely affordable source of protein, because it's in everybody's fields, and therefore it is something. So therefore, in this context, it's useful. In March this year, I'm sure Shruti and whoever else was with us, when we were on an industrial visit, we had gone to Wardha. We went to this Gandhian Institute where the senior person was talking to us, told us that about a few years ago, a lot of people there who used to have cattle, when the cattle became old, they would sell the cattle for meat, for skin, for bones, and that would help them buy new cattle. And it's a part of the ecosystem, but now he said that has been stopped because of this. So therefore, when you're talking about this whole context of understanding diets, food, affordability, protein, it has to be contextual. Okay? And of course, we can a lot of us who can make choices are making choices because we can afford those choices. Because some of those choices may be more expensive. Because if you look at dal is expensive. A lot of other things are very expensive. A lot of people may not be able to afford the extreme poor. If you go to a place like Nagaland, or Arunachal, they have, like Nagaland, the state animal of Nagaland is an animal called Mithun. They are a hybrid between wild oxen and domestic. And they're semi-wild, and they come near villages. The villagers feed them salt and other things, but they also regularly cull them. And the whole village eats. And everybody, irrespective of the economic status, gets a lot of protein. Arunachal also has a lot of these community hunts, which now, because of, in addition to poaching, has affected wildlife. But that was something which was a community source of protein. So when you're talking about diets, which is better, I'm not going to really say, because we have to make choices. And the choices must make sense to us. So please eat up enough, and then maybe we could either have a conversation or you make your choices. I also want to, if you can, to go and read up on the Constitutional Assembly debate on cow slaughter, banning cow slaughter, because that was in terms of, we talked about a certain economic reason. If you look at the reasons why, it is not emotional, it is not religious, it is not about anything else, it's about this thing which is economic. So when we're talking about choices we make, it's better that we look at debates, the context, maybe that will help us understand this better. So, in a lot of places, people, there is a lot of support for veganism. If it makes sense to you, choose it. Okay. And again, in terms of India, when you look at, if you look at most households in small towns and villages, we'll also have chicken on their farm. I mean, so there's a supply of eggs. There's a supply of chicken meat for protein for festival times. And therefore, there is this continuous process of that there is not much impact on the environment. Okay, or goats also will forage, and they are a source of protein. So different contexts will need to be understood differently. And I've also sent an article on this whole issue of palm oil. In places like Malaysia and Indonesia, there is a problem because they're clearing forests. But there is a Nigerian writing about a certain kind of palm oil which comes from Western Nigeria. So please read up on the articles I've sent today. Because again, our choice of food and what is relevant is dependent on our cultural, economic, and food choice context, our traditions. Many of us make changes, and if the changes make sense to you, it's excellent. But in the debates, we'll also need to take a lot of factors into consideration. So that is the my answer to that. Then there's a very intellectual question posed by Abhishek Vidate, asking me to talk about, there are two broad ways of thinking about various issues in the world. One is what is called scientism, and the other is in terms of meta-rationalism. Now, when talking about this whole idea of scientism and ergodicity and things like that, the two people are important there in terms of Krugman and Steven Pinker. So I've sent an article where there's a lot of critique of some of the conclusions of Steven Pinker, not some of his understanding. So that's an interesting article. Please read it. My own, okay, what is scientism in terms of, and scientism is a belief in rational choices, verifiability of a lot of things, and building systems and ensuring better predictability using mathematical probability theory. The other side says that a lot of this, the whole claim of objectivity is problematic because of the context. Now, if you look at somebody like Nicholas Taleb, I've read a lot of his books, and many of his books I've really enjoyed. He says a very interesting thing about knowledge. He says, knowledge is a spectator sport. Do you take responsibility for the things you say? Okay, I want to think about this. Because it's very easy for a lot of us to give gyan. Okay? How relevant is that gyan? What are the consequences of the gyan? How do they apply to different contexts and different individuals? Because there is no one explanation which can fit different situations. He also says that forecasting is bad because we don't know how things will turn out, but being prepared is necessary. So look at options. Are we prepared for whatever may come? So therefore, even when you talk about coronavirus or whatever, some of his ideas are very good. Also, if you look at Kahneman is somebody who won the Nobel Prize for Economics because he's a psychologist. He looked at a lot of cognitive biases. And he says the way we understand a certain thing is the way we frame the problem or the statement or the situation. Okay. So he also looked at in terms of the whole issue of representation, anchoring, availability of choices and facts. All of that is very important. So he was one who said there is a lot of cognitive bias. So when you're talking about anything which is in terms of really scientific, there are many frames of references. So we will need to be careful when you're choosing one or the other. But please read up on Steven Pinker, Nicholas Taleb, Kahneman, Krugman. There's a lot of it available in the public domain. I'm mentioning because possibly I am more comfortable with the ideas of Taleb and Kahneman than with Krugman and Steven Pinker. But maybe some of you may disagree. Of course, read up more on both of them. Maybe you'll be able to look at this. So with this, I think I will move on to today's thing on mental health, especially in this time. But I want to first look at a few things, which may be some preliminary statements and issues I have with definitions. So when you say a mental state, what is a mental state affected by? One, a mental state can be affected by the biochemical balances or imbalances in our brain, which can affect the way we think, the way we respond. So that's one which will need to be understood better. And there's a lot of work going on in this, and that also explains some of the mental disorders. The second thing is in terms of our hormonal secretions, which may be different for men and women in different contexts, and therefore that also affects our mental responses, mental state, that also will need to be taken into consideration. So there's no one way of defining mental state. And the third dimension is our mental state is affected by the way we think, our thoughts and feelings. So when you're talking about thoughts and feelings are affected by what I call a continuum. What's a continuum? A continuum is something which is the past, the present, and the future. All three affect our mental state, and all three affect stress. Okay. And therefore, stress is often something which can affect our mental state significantly. There is a very interesting book called Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers. Okay, so therefore, that is something which is a very interesting book. You must look at the book. Of course, the book gets very heavy. After some time, it seems at least I found it a little difficult to go through after about half the book. It is by Robert Sapolsky. It's a very good book. It also has an interesting chapter on sleep, which I'll discuss a little later. And the basic premise is that when a zebra sees a lion on a hunt or moving, its stress levels build up, and therefore there's pumping of adrenaline, so it can run faster, it can choose evasive action. There are a lot of things that the zebra can do. But once the danger is over, and if the zebra sees a lion at rest, the zebra will not get stressed because it knows it's not going to hunt immediately. And therefore, the zebra is not stressed all the time. Human beings, on the other hand, something which causes us stress can continue to cause us stress after the stressful event is over. Because we connect it to other events, it becomes a part of a memory, it becomes a part of a consciousness. And a lot of us can continue to be stressed. And therefore, I want to look at that when you talk of mental state. What is it that affects our mental state? And how, during this uncertain time, our stress levels can go up because they can be triggered by memories of the past, by events, and some things in the present. So the first part is when you're talking about the past. At an intellectual level, we all know that the past is dead. We can't do anything about it. We can't correct it. Past has with it, it feeds into our sense of inadequacy. The past feeds into a lot of regret. And that regret makes us believe that maybe we are to blame, it's wrong, and therefore it affects our current energy. Second, the past also induces a lot of guilt. We remember events where we blame ourselves, and therefore there's a lot of guilt. Guilt also saps energy. Guilt also induces a lot of stress. And therefore, the past also is a constant reminder of our sense of inadequacy. It's a reminder of failures, it's a reminder of things which we think we did wrong. And it constantly affects and seeps into our present consciousness. So therefore, it's important for us to be able to kind of come to terms with the past. Okay, so that's something which is very important for us. I will come back to this maybe a little later, but this is very important. I want you to note it down. I want you to think about it because it causes a lot of stress. The second thing is about the present. The present is in terms of how do we really see ourselves? Okay. Do we see ourselves in terms of people who can do a lot of things? Or is our present constantly affected by judgments? Judgments by others and judgments by ourselves. Is our present affected by expectations? Now let us look at this this whole COVID situation. Okay.
a lot of us are at home. If a lot of us at home, why can't we use this time, because we don't have to go to work, we don't have to attend college or whatever else, why can't we do use this time to develop new skills or do something? The most important thing is that, is our energy levels something which is not affected by other things? Okay. Now, a lot of people message me and say, oh, you must be reading lots of books. Of course, I love books. I have a lot of books. I have a lot of books which are yet to be read. And they said, you must be reading tons of books. Very often, I'm unable to read. Why? Because a part of me is upset with me because I'm not doing enough to help people in distress. Okay. In the past, whenever there have been situations where there's been communal riots, whatever, I've been active with a lot of students and ex-students and friends in responding to the situation. Now the fact that I'm locked in, I'm unable to do anything. Okay, so I am also inducing present guilt and present feeling of inadequacy because I'm not doing enough. Maybe I'm able to give funds, but a lot of people feel very inadequate and guilty because they're not helping people who need help. So therefore, what is it we are doing? Our energy is getting sucked in by this. Second, expectations. What are these expectations? You're at home, you're not traveling, why didn't you read, why don't you do this? So again, this expectation, I'm not able to also do a lot of this thing because I'm affected by the fear of the disease. Okay, one, in terms of what people close to me get affected, what people in my vicinity get affected. What people who are close to me, people who are older, etc., die, because I'm reading of constantly the news is telling me about high rates of mortality. So even when people call me, when they say, oh, Bombay is still bad, and the number. So that also means that my surroundings is in a context of constant crisis. People are dying, people are not getting better, people who are no close to me are getting affected. So in this state where there is this concern of the possible spread of disease affecting my family and me, is there energy to do what I need to do? So when I don't do that, there's this double jeopardy. One, I'm not able to do because there is fear, there is things which is affecting my energy. Second, I'm also beating myself up and saying that, oh my God, you're not doing this, you're not reading, you're not writing, you're not doing this. So we're often constantly attacking ourselves. So the most important thing for us is be comfortable in terms of accept what is happening. It's not necessary for us to be productive all the time. Because often when we think we are productive, it's just motions of productivity. I'm going to college, I am maybe teaching. When I'm teaching, it's possible that maybe I'm regurgitating all like that I already know. Maybe so I need to be comfortable what I'm doing, what I'm capable of, given these emotional and mental constraints. So, if you're talking about your mental health, please understand this. How much of a past is getting triggered off, which is causing you stress? How much of your current expectations is something? And therefore, you're also somebody who absorbs a lot of things. Okay? When we see things, I'm not filtering. When I see things being happy and doing baking and doing all kinds of stuff, I'm telling myself, oh my God, they're doing, I'm not doing. Okay. Or we're looking at people who are doing all kinds of isometrics or whatever else, why am I doing? So some of us have space constraints, some of us have resource constraints. A lot of these things which doesn't allow us to do what we can. You know, somebody like me is extremely privileged. Why am I privileged? I'm living in a house which is fairly large. If I want to walk, I can walk within the house itself, I don't need to go down. And actually for the first 3 months, I didn't step out. And it's possible for me to do that. It's also possible for me to do that because of the kind of person I am. I'm an introvert. I don't need a lot of social stimulus as many others do. So my example can be an example for anybody else. And for 5th of June in the morning, I'm going cycling. That's possible because I'm close to a place where cycling is possible. Somebody gifted me a cycle many years ago, so I have a resource which is available. I live in a space, it is conducive to that. So if others see me, it's very unfortunate if they compare themselves. So So what is the problem for a lot of us who are locked in and going through various situations? We're constantly comparing ourselves. Look at what other people are doing or able to do. Because everybody's context is different. Some of us live in home situations where our parents' income is significantly affected. Okay. Also, this whole uncertainty, when is this going to end? So therefore, that is something which we must understand, that are we stressing ourselves? Are we allowing other people to stress us? Because the current situation is difficult. And the third part is we are constantly thinking about the future. And uncertainty is something which can really cause a lot of anxiety. When will this end? What will change? I'm also looking at people who are saying that maybe 130 million people are going to completely exhaust their savings, maybe within the Indian context itself. So what does that mean? How do we survive? What about safety nets for the future? And this is where I want us to look at in terms of when you're talking about the word migrant. See, in a certain sense, most of us are migrants. If you look at Mumbai city is a city of migrants. Okay. Except the Bhandaris and Kohlis, the original residents, all of us are migrants. And many of us have come at different points of time. Migrants with economic and social privilege are not affected. Who are the ones who are affected? Who are the ones who are affected? Are the very poor who have to pay rent? But somebody like me, if I get my regular salary, as a part of my salary, there's something called housing allowance. And because I'm in a permanent job, and therefore my rental needs and others will get taken care of, if my salary comes in, at that time, the house rent is deducted. But people are living on rent in other places. People who give out their house for rent, they also need to have their liquidity moving. They put pressure. So who pays for electricity? Who pays for this? Because they're only if they're earning, can some of these needs can get taken care of. So if a lot of small and medium enterprises are shut, so the very poor are the worst affected. And they're not able to pay rent, electricity, they're not able to pay for the basic. So it's not just food. A lot of basic medical needs, sanitation needs, hygiene needs. Where is the money going to come from? And therefore we have a system where if 90% of the people are in the unorganized sector, there is zero safety net. So when you're talking about the so-called migrant workers, we're looking at their concern, where is the next meal going to come from? Who's going to pay for whatever our needs are? So therefore, since there is no guarantee from the state or social support groups, a lot of them have just started moving out, had started moving out in April and May. So that is something which I want us to look at. So anxiety, in terms of because of uncertainty, is a huge source of stress. So when I'm looking at the mental state, please understand this continuum is there. And different people are affected by different aspects of this continuum. For some people, the past has a lot of impact. For some people, the present has. For some people, the future has. For some people, all three have much more than in terms of anybody else. And therefore, that is something which we need to understand. Also, a lot of us are constantly dealing with our own demons. Demons is events, incidents in the past which we've not been able to come to terms with. So therefore, in that context, I want to look at definitions of public health. One definition of public health is emotional, psychological, and social well-being. Again, all these are not objective statements. So when you say social well-being, it means different things for different people. And therefore, you can have a lot of guilt if you think, I don't have too many friends. So it's an indication of social inadequacy. Or is it an indication of context in which social contact has not been built up for various reasons, which is in the, for a variety of reasons. I'll give you this small thing. Recently, I was a young girl I know who is in third standard. She's very scared to go to school. She loves her friends, she wants to be friends, because she's somebody who has a learning disability and can't read. And all her friends make fun of the fact that she can't read. And therefore, for her, it's extremely stressful. So for the idea of school has a lot of these kind of stresses. So when do we factor in these kind of situations and needs? There are inadequacies possibly highlighted by others. Okay. Often in jest, because for other people it is, you know, it's a matter of joke. I mean, if we find it very funny. A lot of people who have inadequacy with language, inadequacy with communication, can be the butt of jokes. And if you remember those who have been my students, I always say that, do you know the meaning of the word pulling somebody's leg? It's come in the context of the French Revolution. When people being hanged from crude nooses would not die, and somebody would go and pull their legs to facilitate faster death. And others would see it and find it very funny and laugh. So we need to understand in terms of where the social stresses will come. So when you say social well-being, it's not just about meeting people, because meeting people sometimes who are more privileged than us can be very, or seem more capable, can be a source of stress. So if you look at the World Health definition, first it says World Health definition deals with emotional well-being, that is, where individual, this is something again, you know, well-being where an individual realizes his own abilities. Here, the World Health Organization doesn't deal with the concept of self-esteem. Many of us tend to underestimate our abilities, or we tend to compare ourselves unfavorably with other people all the time. And therefore, even without this context, our mental state is affected by a lot of stress, because there's a serious sense of personal inadequacy. So therefore, this is important. When you say, when a person realizes ability, it's a very, very interesting definition. But the definition is a problem, because it does not look at a certain context in which we understand abilities. If people have not been appreciative of our abilities, a lot of us don't believe we have any abilities. Okay. If we have been comparing ourselves unfairly with other people, we will never really appreciate our abilities. So therefore, that is something which I want to say. Please examine your own reality checks about yourselves. Where has it come from? Who's put it there? How often are you continuously being stressful about yourself? Especially bright people can also suffer from extremely low self-esteem, because bright people think they're not doing enough. Okay? For whatever reasons, and therefore that can be, and they feel, and also bright people feel, because they feel inadequate about their abilities, sometimes very stressed about writing, about presenting, about doing a lot of things. So it can cause severe anxiety, because you think, oh, I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do. But you also believe, I don't think I'm capable of producing excellent dissertations or excellent term papers or excellent writing, and therefore I don't. That is something which I want us to examine, that how often are we the source of our own stress in terms of questioning our abilities. Okay. Also, the next part of the WHO definition said that we can cope with life in terms of being productive. We are coping, we are productive people. How do you define productivity? And especially at this time. So productivity can be in terms of many ways in which we can. And so all of us can be and are productive. But we don't acknowledge our productivity. And therefore that's something that's important. You know, when I was reading this book, Invisible Women, okay, somebody said that when we talk about working women, we only talk about women who are paid for their work. All women work. When we make this distinction, people who do a lot of unpaid work feel they're not productive, feel they're not good enough, feel they're not as capable,
feel when they are inadequate when they compare with women who are paid for their work. And a lot of us at home are contributing productively. But we're only looking at intellectual productivity, we're looking at certain definitions of productivity. And therefore, that's something which I again want all of us to look at, because when you use words like being productive, what does it mean? Who evaluates and defines productivity? And in terms of various kinds of productivity. So if, in terms of what are the kind of things we'll be able to do, we'll be able to do better if we don't go by these definitions. Figure out what definitions or how will you evaluate these definitions. And in terms of the last part of the definition, WHO says, somebody who's able to contribute to his or her own community. This for a lot of us is a problem now. When you're locked down, you're not able to contribute to the community. So can you see the kind of inadequacy it can engender? And therefore, when you're talking about your definitions of mental health, I want you to be careful of mental state. Please be nice to yourselves. When I say nice, be compassionate with yourself. On the 26th of June, a very, very remarkable young lady, Agrima Basheen, is doing a session on self-compassion. I'm not sure whether it is open to everybody else. I've just asked for information. Maybe if it is, maybe some of you can attend that session. All of us need, what I said, constant, tender, loving care. Because we're constantly, I always tell people, we are comparing ourselves unfavorably with people who are so different from us. And we're not acknowledging the kind of things which we do. So therefore, that's something which is important. The second part, I'm going to request Abhishek Vidati to play a song before I play the song, is all of us are filled with different kinds of dimensions within ourselves. Like Robert Falcom says, we all have committees in our heads. The song I'm asking Abhishek Vidati to play is a song called I Contain Multitudes. It's a song which is could be about American society, it could be about individuals. You can read it at different levels. I love the song. For me, it was more about myself. So this song has different meanings. I'm playing it in this context of ourselves. Abhishek, can you please play the song? Hello, Abhishek. I don't know how many of you can relate to it, to the song. I love Bob Dylan, so I'm not sure whether all of you love Bob Dylan. Many of you don't like it. I remember one of my students said, "So why do you play Bob Dylan? He's so puck out." Maybe if you don't like, sorry. But there are some parts of the lyrics which I thought were beautiful, which I said, all of us are full of contradictions. We're human beings, and all kinds of thoughts go through our heads. So sometimes we hate ourselves for the kind of thoughts we think, for the kind of drives we have, emotions we have. It's all a part of who we are. We need to be comfortable with that. Sometimes they're extremely moralistic. I can't think like that. I shouldn't think like that. I think that is something which we need to avoid, because that can be very, very detrimental to your mental well-being. Because this is something, and a very important part of what we need to do is also to come to terms with the past. I will just come to that theme in some time. But first, what I wanted to say is that we are all people with multiple dimensions. And no dimensions are good or bad. All dimensions are something which we channelize in different ways. And therefore, for us to be judgmental about ourselves is the last thing we should be doing now. And also, when you're talking about mental health, what do we need to do to feel good about ourselves? This is the first question. How do we feel good about ourselves? The first thing is to be comfortable with contradictions, to accept that the past is dead, and believe that each one of us is equipped with what is necessary to handle whatever is thrown at us in the future. All of us have come through all kinds of battles. All of us are very resilient. So if you have tackled some of the toughest challenges, you'll be able to tackle whatever challenges comes in the future. All of you have various kinds of competencies. So this first thing is in terms of feeling good about ourselves is, please continuously work on a self-esteem. Stop comparing, start acknowledging. Second, in terms of, be conscious when you're allowing fears to overwhelm you, when you're allowing anxiety to overwhelm you, when you're allowing anger to overwhelm you. Because all of this are emotions which can drain your emotional energy. And therefore, that is something to be conscious. So what can we do when you feel it's building up? One of the important things is build networks where we can talk to each other. Find, if you don't have too many people you can talk to, do things which are cathartic. Is it writing? Is it doing things? We'll need to figure out what is it that so if you listen to your body and mind, it will start telling you that it is. And before it reaches a certain stage, it becomes too difficult. If you can find ways to be active, to do something, what is it that is relevant for you? You will have to figure that out. So therefore, that is something which we must look at. Also, they say mental good health is also having, in terms of a range of interesting, good personal relationships. So how do we nurture relationships? How are we there for other people? How do we seek such relationships? And the last thing which I really laugh like is, laughter is one of the best things for mental health. Okay, I remember, I don't know how many of you remember, there used to be this magazine called Reader's Digest. At least our home used to get it. And there was one page I often, that was the first thing I read. It said, laughter the best medicine. And in laughter they said, are you somebody who can laugh at yourself? Okay. So self-deprecating humor is something which is very, 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 very useful. What is, can you laugh? So sometimes we take ourselves too seriously. The ability to laugh at ourselves means we don't take ourselves too seriously. We are not too judgmental about ourselves. We stop expecting too much from ourselves. We understand. We should laugh. No, we are all human. Stop worrying about what people think. You know, there are these things. You know, I've shared this with my students, but there are two instances which I want to share. You know, once on a camp, I was telling students in terms of how to be careful, and because we are sitting on a slope, and how to walk across a wet patch. I said this and I started walking and I fell completely on my face.
And I'm sure the students, they really want to laugh because it was so funny. Okay. But if I get upset with myself for falling, or if I get upset if people laugh, I'm not seeing the funniness in that. I don't know, I mean this, I'm sure she's not on this group. There was this former student of mine, Radhika Shah. She was in a camp again in the jungles, and she had a very heavy fall. And all of us worried, ran, and when we ran, we realized, and she was laughing uncontrollably. Because she thought it so funny that she slipped and fell. And therefore, possibly, I'm sure it helped release embarrassment, it helped deal with pain. That's something which is very important for us. Can we find ways to laugh at ourselves? Because this is something a lot of people say is very important. And stop taking yourself too seriously. I've shared this with other people. Some of you are teachers, want to be teachers. I read many years ago 10 commandments, and the 8th one is very important for me. It says, thou shalt take your calling seriously, but don't take yourself too seriously. So I can understand your concerns about the world, about what you want to achieve. But don't take yourself too seriously, because that puts too much pressure. And the last part of thing is, when people call you names, say things about you in terms of, you know, it's in a certain context. You know, I remember, you know, those of you who come for camps, I'm very hard taskmaster. Sometimes there's not enough. I remember one camp, we landed at some place, we traveled through the night, we landed at 5 in the morning. I gave people about an hour to have a bath and get ready. And we had breakfast and we went for a long trek. And some of the girls who were there were very, very angry. Their first trekking experience and to walk some 11 kilometers. So they said, this Darinda sleeps. So my volunteers were so happy to hear somebody call me Darinda. They gleefully came and told me, sir, they're calling you Darinda. And I also laughed for this. But sometimes maybe if I get hurt and upset with what people are saying, there's a certain context with things are said. So if you can see it in some perspective. So when you talk about this whole issue of coming to terms with the past, everything which has happened in our lives, our so-called failures, our so-called bursts of anger, our so-called meanness, exists in a certain context. If I can see the context and let it go. Okay. Now, before I continue, request Abhishek, this not without time to, can you play the next song, please? Okay. This song called Forgiveness. I will talk about why I'm using this song.
Thing on your mind today, it always goes to those who don't deserve. It's the opposite of how you feel when the pain they caused is just too real. Takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness. Forgiveness. In the face of all your pride, it moves away the mad inside. It's always anger's own worst enemy. Even when the jury and the judge say you got a right to hold a grudge, it's the whisper in your ear saying set it free. Forgiveness. Prisoner free, there is no end to what its power can do. So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness. Forgiveness.
What is?
Okay. The reason I play the song is because we all need to practice a lot of forgiveness with ourselves. Okay. Some of us, or many of us, hate parts of ourselves. We are not able to forgive ourselves for the words we've said, okay, for the things we've done. So forgiveness is learning to let go, because, as I said, everything we say and do is always in a certain context. So it's not just about forgiving others, it's about forgiving yourself. Because any kind of grudge only consumes you. That's what the song says. The prisoner that it sets free is, I mean, the best benefit is us. Because we can be locked in bitterness, hatred, all kinds of judgments. But as I said, before we do it with ourselves, start with before we do it with other people, see if you can start with yourself, because that's the most important thing. Are we compassionate with ourselves? Are we kind to ourselves? And especially at this time, it is extremely crucial. Because stop beating yourself for not completing work which you think you could have done, for not doing an exercise. All that's irrelevant. Okay. Yes. We must try and push ourselves, if we're getting into depression, to do things which will possibly give us energy. But if it can't happen, find help, do other things. But the last thing you should do is to beat yourself up. So these 3 months, if you've not been productive according to somebody else's standards or your standards, doesn't matter. Okay? There's still a lot of life where we can contribute, where you can do. We all need to heal ourselves with all the kinds of beating up you do. There's a word which I normally use with some people. It's called self-flagellation. What is self-flagellation? The act of beating ourselves up. So that's something which you, if you are talking about things like mental health, because sometimes we are too harsh on ourselves. Sometimes we push ourselves to do things which are not healthy. You know, like I'll give an example in terms of, and I had a student, this was about 20 years ago. She was somebody who said, sir, I cannot study beyond 8 hours a day. UPSC is my goal. This is the maximum I can do. And I said, that's the best. You decide how much you can study. A lot of people push them to study 10, 12 hours. That's unproductive. You decide how much you can manage, how much you can do. Give yourself rest. Give yourself time to unwind. Give yourself time to, in terms of, you know, fill, to laugh, to take care of other parts of yourself. As a human person, we have a social self, your emotional self, we have musical self. All of it nourishes us. Listen to music, listen to jokes, listen to things. And sometimes just do nothing. Stare at the ceiling. It's okay. Why is this constant pressure on yourself to do something?
We all will find reasons and purpose when we are ready. It'll happen. When it's not happening, figure out why it's not happening. Are you dissipating your own energy with harsh expectations and things like that? So therefore, that's something which we will need to see how we can figure out. I've taken too much of my time. Towards the end, I want to talk about, I've sent an article on a book by Benjamin Brown, where he talks about six factors for mental hygiene. Because our mind can be cluttered with a lot of negativity, our mind can be cluttered with a lot of self-damaging thoughts. So therefore, mental hygiene is important. I'm not very happy with the six things which he suggests. Some of you will have to discover something which works for you, but that's something which I thought, the first in terms of how do you transform, transcend your environment, go beyond the limitations which are set by environment. Because the human mind is capable of figuring out a lot of things it can do beyond the existing social, mental, emotional, economic environment. Second is, okay, one in terms, this is what is said, which the part I like is, cultivate constructive acceptance. Okay. If there's certain things which I can't do in the same area, what is it that I can do better? So, I'm a person who still struggles with writing. So, but I'm somebody who enjoys talking, and so therefore I've chosen a profession which allows me to talk and express myself. And as I talk, other parts of my brain suggest more ideas and insights. As I talk, so therefore it releases a lot of energy. And when you ask me questions, it stimulates me a lot and makes me think of things which I've not thought for some time. So figure out what are the kind of things where you work best. Is it writing? Is it speaking? Is it doing? So constructive acceptance is not stopping something which, in that sense, blocks you. So in the book it talks about, as an example, you can look at it. The third is visualize your ideal self. Now this is something which is a little difficult and can be problematic. Sometimes our so-called ideal self is unrealistic. Sometimes we create images of ourselves which wants to be this perfect person. Perfect thinker, perfect social person, perfect leader. There's nothing like perfect. What's an ideal self? An ideal self is, how can you visualize yourself where all your energies are being released? Where you're in touch with all your talents, energies, capabilities. Because don't define yourself by who you are now. Because this comparing and all this is something which is a problem. If I go back to my 19-year-old self or 21-year-old self, I had no confidence in my ability to speak in public. Okay, it blocked a lot of my thinking. Okay, I had no confidence in so many of my abilities which seem so easy now. So therefore, at that time, I blocked a lot of my energies because it was very difficult for me visualize my all the kind of talents which, you know, whether it was sense of humor, whether it was whatever else, it was something which is blocked. So therefore, that's something which is there. Also, constantly use a lot of positive affirmations. Acknowledge small things which you can do, which are able to, difficulties you're able to overcome. So if you're able to overcome some uncertainty, if you're able to overcome some negativity, acknowledge it. Nurture that. That's something that's very important. And in terms of, he uses a word, something called practice psychological counterpunching. So if you have negative ideas about the way you're approaching things, what are the other kind of things you have done and you can do which can overcome this? Okay? How can you really counter all these negative judgments? Okay. And in terms of, choose your own internal state of mind, composure, whatever else. So there are a lot of things which you can do. But my best, most not best really, in terms of most relevant advice which works for me, it can work for you in different ways, is figure out how you can see yourself more positively. How can you be more compassionate? Stop judging yourself. Try and come to terms with different parts of yourself. We all have multiple dimensions of ourselves. But the most important takeaway today is please forgive yourself for what has happened. Forgive yourself for what you're doing today, which you think may not be in the best level, best capacity. It will help. Be kind to yourself. Be your best friend. Be compassionate. Be empathetic with yourself. And I want to close with, when you say self-love, this is something I've done in class, but I want, many people may have forgotten. There was a psychologist called Eric Fromm. Eric Fromm was for some time worked with Sigmund Freud. He had four dimensions of love. Respect, understanding, concern, and taking care. Do these four for yourself. Respect for yourself, for who you are, for what you are, because you are, every one of us is a blessing in different ways to different people. Stop looking at what is it that you could have done, should have done. So respect yourself. Understand yourself. Understand the different things of why you do what you do. Okay. Give yourself a lot of tender, loving care. Be concerned about your feelings. Okay. And see how you can heal them. I'll stop here. I don't know whether I've been relevant. I'm not a psychologist. But this is something which I want to share. And these two songs I thought would be useful. I've really gone way beyond my time. Sorry for that. Any questions? Whatever else. Yeah.
Sir, this is a question by Shashwati Shiva.
Yeah.
She agrees with your points about veganism, but cannot argue veganism isn't without taking animal cruelty into account. It's not just about what it does to the planet. It also has deep impact on sentient beings, especially factory farming, hugely problematic.
No, I completely agree with all kinds of things which have animal cruelty, factory farming, all these are serious issues. But when you're talking about the words like sentient beings, because there is a lot of work in terms of plants and various kinds of things also sentient. So therefore, we need to look at our body in terms of elementary canal. There are a lot of issues, as I said. But yes, cruelty of any form, unnatural ways in terms of producing, all of that is seriously problematic. But if you look at our body and our histories and cultures, there will be different perspectives which we will also need to understand. Veganism is one perspective which has a lot of worth for many, many people. I definitely appreciate that. But as I said, that cannot be the only perspective, because it also, we need to figure out in terms of how human societies have developed and what makes sense to them now. So that's the thing which I want to say. Yes, I agree about factory farming and cruelty and this whole thing about sentient beings. I do agree. But I think there is other ways of also looking at this.
Next question is by Akash. There is a lot of socio-religious pressures which compound stress, especially in families where men have to perform the role of bread earners and women have to perform the role of childbearers. But in 2020, we can no longer live by these binary roles. And that is why many youngsters are adapting to new approaches to life, like choosing to stay a bachelor or spinster, polyamory, etc. Do you think it's important to challenge social norms of our own mental, for our own mental peace in contemporary times?
Of course, Akash, I completely agree. A lot of our shoulds in life are seriously problematic. I'm not just talking about roles. I'm also talking about expectations. You know, I don't know how many of you know, in terms of the, this is a forward which I received many years ago, and it keeps coming back. It says that, you know, if you get 98%, and your parents say, you know, what happened to the remaining 2%? So sometimes there is so much of pressure in terms of performing all the time. That's why I said, it's not just about roles. It's also about this whole need to be productive. It's okay not to be productive. It's okay to do what we can. It's okay to take a break. It's okay to also figure out, you know, at this moment I'm feeling uncomfortable, tired. Can I rejuvenate myself? So giving time and space for that is important. But the point you said is very, very true. But while we challenge, we also need to find solutions which also help us. If we're social beings, what's the best way to take care of our social needs? What's the best way to take care of our emotional needs? Sometimes just because we've seen marriages being problematic and conflict prone, does not mean we cannot create better quality relationships. There are a lot of possibilities. We need to explore from a level of compassion for ourselves and our needs. So therefore, what works is good, but definitely a lot of things, whether it's religious or social, sometimes the way it's interpreted causes so much of damage. And therefore, this whole need to forgive, the whole need to be compassionate is very, very major. Yeah.
Next question is by Parikshit. When mental health is more than the presence and absence of emotional states, this state may be seen to occur in any age group. So how effective and cost effective are school-based mental health treatments for special needs school children? And shouldn't it be made very mandatory to talk about mental health and issues openly without making it a taboo in our society?
Parikshit, I completely agree with you. A lot of us don't really acknowledge mental health, because when you don't take our mental health or we don't have proper mental hygiene, a lot of mental health issues can get into mental illness. Second, I also talked about in terms of a lot of our disorders, maybe because of many things beyond the social-cultural thing. It's also because of the biochemical reactions in the head and a lot of things which are maybe genetic and otherwise. So therefore, there's a need for a lot of understanding. And that is why it's very important at all, not just school. In colleges, we have no real mental health training for any of you. There may be some programs in a limited way try to give, but on a regular basis, there's no way in which we address mental health issues, because colleges can also be the biggest source of stress, because college also, or schools also, make us compare ourselves with other people. When we see a lot of other people getting acknowledgement, we don't get. So there's a lot of issues in any kind of context. So therefore, mental health is something. So we need to teach people in terms of how do we take care of ourselves. They say that every day, each one of us receives more than 150 negative messages. What does that mean? If I smile at a friend and a friend doesn't smile at me, basically start thinking, have I done something wrong? Am I inadequate? So there are so many of these things which leads to this. And also the fact that in the current situation, most of us have no way of receiving any kind of positive social stimulus. Smiles, hugs, cheerful exchanges. So therefore, mental health is, even in this, nobody is really addressing mental health. Okay. Even today in the coronavirus situation, how much are we really addressing mental health? We are not. And I'm very, very happy this group decided to put mental health. Maybe you will need somebody who's better than me to talk to you about this. But if each one of us can talk, start taking care of ourselves, being respectful, being understanding, stop comparing ourselves, okay? Stop expecting too much from yourself. If you acknowledge yourself, next time, automatically you'll find more energy. Second, set your own pace for what works. Because sometimes other people's pace cannot work for you. I'll give an example. You know, this about 10 years ago, 12 years ago, I did my first full marathon. I've never run in my life, so I couldn't run. And I, one friend of mine became a self-appointed trainer. So you'll get very obsessed. Oh, you haven't run so much. So I decided that, you know, I would just not listen to him, because I decided my pace is important. And the end of it, I was running the marathon to see whether I could complete it. I completed 5 hours, some 40, my God knows how many, 4, 10 minutes or something. The winner was 2 hours. I'm not comparing. I'm doing, of course, I didn't run the full marathon. I ran 29 kilometers, walked the rest. But for me, completion was important. So you set your own targets. It need not be defined by what other people do. Whether it is writing every day, speaking every day, you set. And you'll find that if it stimulates you, keep doing it. Maybe you'll become better. But all the setting standards and feeling inadequate if you don't meet is unhealthy. You will definitely improve as you keep doing, as your body adjusts, as your body finds more energy, as you build up your muscle strength similarly. spend time developing creative energy muscle, creative muscles in your brain. It'll take a lot of time because we've not really built it. Build our intellectual energy by debating, discussing, reading. But don't let the pace define you. You define how much you want to do. It's okay if you don't read books for 2 weeks. It's completely okay. Please stop having these pressure goals in yourself. Goals will happen. Okay. You know, close friends of mine are very, very worried that I'm going to retire in 1.5 years exactly. They all know that I can't sit at home. So they all put pressure. Oh, are you planning for the future? I said, I don't. Let's see what happens. So yeah, I'll figure out. So now itself, thinking, do this, do that. Why? When it happens. So I always tell people, cross the bridge when you come to it. Remember what I said about Nicholas Taleb? It's good to be prepared. But don't indulge in all kinds of forecasting. This can happen, that can happen. Be prepared to the best extent you can. Be kind to yourself. Okay? Give yourself a lot of tender, loving care. That's the only thing I want to keep repeating. Because we're all so harsh on ourselves. So many people who talk to me, I know they are so demanding and harsh on themselves. It is very sad. I just want to hug them and shake them up and say, chill. Okay, next question.
Next question is by Abhishek.
Yeah.
You mentioned women doing household work not being counted under working women. For a long time as a society, we have taken women's unpaid labor for granted. If it wasn't for this conveniently dismissed labor of love, the world economy would collapse in a day. There are some proposals to acknowledge this importance of kin work to our economy by direct cash transfers or paid maternity leaves, etc. Do you have any policy recommendations, either radical or progressive?
You know, see, before I make policy recommendations, look at what different countries have started doing. Look at what Iceland has done. Look at what Australia has done. Look at what Finland, Sweden. Many of them are inadequate. And some of you, I hope, will read this book, Invisible Women. You may get ideas. So before I make a policy recommendation, when I say unpaid work, it's not always necessarily a work of love. It's a work which people expect us to do, women to do. So we are doing because nobody else does it. So if you go to Uttarakhand, every day, every 3 days, women walk 15 kilometers up and down hills to collect fuel wood. If you go to villages, even in Raigad and other places which are in the hills, people have to walk about 15 kilometers every 3-4 days for drinking water. So it's not really a labor of love, it's a labor of compulsion. And of course, because they do that, there is no time to do paid work. So therefore, compensating them for that is important. But even as children and others, a lot of us do a lot of unpaid work because we're all, you know, our parents are you're very lazy. Of course, we all work. Okay. Maybe it's not acknowledged. So sometimes we feel very demotivated. Kitna bhi karo, nobody appreciates. So all of us need to be more appreciative. Of course, all of us need to be more appreciative of our mothers. We all cook, we only complain when we think the food is not up to our standard of taste. Okay. We don't appreciate for all the hard work. So a lot of create what I call a community of appreciation, genuine appreciation. I always tell people, don't say something is nice. Nice is a brand of biscuit. So find ways to actually appreciate in terms of specific things or what we need to appreciate. All of us benefit when we are acknowledged. Yeah, so that's important. Yeah.
Manali Sharma, please ask your question.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, very much.
Sir, I think that a lot of students here, especially the ones who have, as you said, Mumbai, came to Mumbai as students from different parts of the country. We became a sort of a diasporic community in a way. And now that most of us, the fortunate ones, have come home and, with this pandemic and lockdown, are back to environments where we went away from, are experiencing, I don't know about others, but the challenges faced by a diasporic community, like a sense of alienation, a lot of identity crisis happening. That is something which is happening to a lot of us, because in most cases, When we went away from home, we also experienced a lot of freedom. We got chances to discover ourselves, which we probably never had before. At least I never had before. And staying away from home did that to me. And in the time that you are by yourself, studying or doing whatever, you discover and develop your own sense of identity, which when you now have come back home to it is constantly challenged because your parents have not changed at the pace which you have probably. So that sense of alienation with the family that you probably used to live in, that identity crisis which you go through, what do you think can be done to tackle that? Because a lot of times you can't really blame them. It's your surrounding which changed. And it took me a lot of time to accept that, you know, blaming is no solution. But then what can be done?
Yeah. Okay, let me answer. There is one part of the question I want to answer, which is not really a question, but I want to address it. You know, when you take college, especially, we put a lot of emphasis on attendance. And we punish people who don't have attendance. Because then you're giving important procedure over people or process over people. A lot of people who come from outer station to study colleges in Mumbai, there's a huge thing of alienation. Sometimes they stay in comfortable friends and home network, and they come to a college which is big, where people have their own groups, where you're not easily accepted. So there's a lot of struggle for people who come from outside to settle. Some people say settle because they find people who are supportive. For some people, it may take 2-3 years and may never find. So therefore, there is this struggle always in new environments. So therefore, that's something which, again, a lot of colleges and places are not giving enough support in terms of, you know, mental hygiene support for these people who come to adjust, to deal with different kind of pressures and demands and challenges. Okay, that's one part of it. Second, what you say is very true. It's not just in terms of freedom, but also anybody who stays out and comes back to a fixed set, there are also expectations are different, your experiences are different. And sometimes also the social values which are relevant in a certain context, you may have either outgrown or you found others. So these clashes will be there. So therefore, when I say, if you love people, whether your parents or yourself, when you say understanding issue, yes, that understanding, as you said, is very important. Because they have been in a certain context. So sometimes giving understanding when the demands are extremely hurtful or stressful is difficult. But over a period of time, respect for others and ourselves will need to be cultivated, because all of us are products of our conditioning, of our context. So therefore, all the time may not be easy. So therefore, we will need to figure out ways in which we address this. And it is an ongoing process. So when I look at all of us, I always tell everybody, students and grown-ups, all of us are still work in progress. So we may not have figured out the best way to respond to a certain kind of stress, a certain kind of demand, or certain needs of mental health. All of us are figuring out. Some of us figure it out with help, some of us figure it ourselves. So what you say is very true. To understand others and their context is important. Understanding yourself is also important. One thing before I go to the next question is, see, most important thing is, when you get feedback from people, okay, do you have filtering mechanisms for feedback? What do I mean by that? All feedback has part fact and part interpretation. And interpretation often is very huge. Okay. Fact may be very little. So therefore, this filtering in your head, before you internalize feedback, before you agree what people are saying, that kind of thing is very important. So this filtering mechanism where you are able to look at this. Second, a lot of feedback is often labels. And labels are problematic, because when people call us lazy, irresponsible, immature, these words don't mean anything. Because so-called maturity itself is multiple dimensional, and it's always contextual. So for us to be able to understand that these labels may have different meanings, you need to look at the fact which invited a certain comment to see, was the fact itself a problem, not a problem, are people overreacting? All of that's important when you filter information. So when you have feedback, Please look at the context. That's why I said even at the past or present, look at everything from the context in which feedback or responses come. I hope I've answered your question. Yeah.
Sir, I'm so sorry, Shruti. There's an extension to what you said. I was also wondering ever since I came back home, it's been three and a half months now. How do you talk about mental health to your parents? Because it's the baton of, being aware and staying mentally healthy, all of that is always expected out of children. And a lot of times, parenting in most cases goes really wrong a lot of times. So how do you maybe suggest to parents that, you know, you should also go for therapy along with me? How do you say that?
Okay, the first thing is, as I said, is as a part of conditioning, a lot of my generation possibly has never really thought of mental health. We never really thought about the importance of emotions, because we feel that or don't feel that. Because even when people feel upset, we say, don't feel upset. So the importance of feelings, the need to acknowledge feelings, is something which has not been a part of our learning, conditioning, growing up. So therefore, for us, maybe the vocabulary, or that's a blind spot. So therefore, making us understand is going to be a difficult task, because then you need to find a vocabulary from our context in which you can address. And also, going for therapy is possibly the final stage. Before therapy, if we can also create context in which they are able to express their own feelings first in terms of in small ways and things like that, will possibly make them feel more comfortable. Or maybe it's also possible that a lot of our parents have never really received acknowledgement in the kind of way in which they thought we should be giving. Am I audible?
Yes.
So there's a lot of feeling. So those also will have to be addressed by us, because in terms of expectations, maybe appreciation, acknowledgement may have been inadequate. We don't know. So therefore, we must create a context where we're able to beginning to talk. The handicap is we just still don't have the verbal tools which they can relate to, because our verbal tools will not make sense to them, because that is something which is not a part of their thinking. You know, I talked about Nicholas Taleb. He uses a term called black swan. Now, what is black swan? For Europeans, swans were only white. When black swans came, they didn't recognize them. So if I have grown up not believing that emotions are important, and somebody is saying that emotions matter or we need to express, so a lot of time they may think it's overreacting or excuses. So for them to even understand that will possibly take time and need, as I keep saying, how do we create context of conversation, listening, which can help.
Thank you. Next question is by Noel. How can one cope with social stress when there are so many things like friendship fading away, lots of arguments happening and stuff at one time, keeping your self-respect in consideration?
Okay, the first thing is, see, all of us have need for friends. And therefore, it's important that we, some of us are lucky to get friends who are supportive. Many of us may have friends who are insensitive. And therefore, the first thing about friendship is, if you realize that any kind of friendly friendship, relationship context is toxic, find ways in which you protect yourself. You need to develop insulation where the hurts don't penetrate. And if you have the option of having other relationship, you need to move away from toxic friendships and relationships. But it is a multiple way of doing it. So what you say is true, that, you know, there are so many expectations, social stresses. So you'll have to take small steps in first loving yourself, respecting yourself, not letting other people's comment define you. So you'll have to start with yourself. And slowly, maybe it'll also be useful if you are familiar with now tools like nonviolent communication. All of you, after this, please go and look at nonviolent communication, because nonviolent communication is both therapeutic and it's also a very healthy way of communicating. I'm sure there are many such tools available how do you develop assertiveness, where you take a stand that you don't allow people to push you around. All of these will need both help and continuous effort. So the answer for that is yes, it's very difficult. Start with strengthening yourself, start with acknowledging yourself, and find tools which help you.
Next question is by Rohit. Can handling criticism some way or the other affect to promote self-centered nature within decision makers, which may indirectly cause stress to the elements of group society?
Okay, can you please repeat the question? First part of the question, my audio is bad. Yeah.
Can handling criticism some way or the other affect to promote self-centered nature within decision makers, which may indirectly cause stress to the elements of group or society?
Okay. The first thing is that when you're talking about criticism, criticism is a form of feedback. And we must have ways in which we are able to break down criticism to look at different dimensions to see what is useful, what is not useful. Second, if people are self-centered, self-centeredness also comes with a lot of selfishness, because in terms of where either people are not able to love themselves, people have too many defenses. So therefore, yes, that can come in the, so self-centered leadership can, or can be a real problem when you're working with groups. So when you talk about groups, you need to find out what are the kind of activities one can use to nurture the group, where we will build bridges between different people, we are able to listen to different people. Say this multi-level action. Self-centeredness is definitely a problem. It blocks us from understanding people. It blocks us from listening to people. It blocks us from being empathetic to people. And therefore, in a lot of leadership training, we are not really covering this, especially when you talk about in terms of MBA programs, etc. There is a lot of lacunae. We're not building managers who are more empathetic and things like that. There is a useful article, which is a very old article. Maybe some of it is outdated. There's an article, if you can find online, called Myth of the Well-Educated Manager. It's an old, it's a 1969 article. I don't remember the author, 67 or 68. A lot of the essay is very sexist. The kind of vocabulary it uses is only about men. It's not about women. In one of the points there, it says that a lot of managers, engineers are emotion blind. Okay. They're taught to only look at rational processes, machines, rational outcomes. So we will also need to build a lot of empathy training into management education, into political education, into all kinds of education, because empathy is often lacking. So therefore, self-centeredness means a lack of empathy. Okay. I hope I've answered your question, Rohit.
Yeah. Abhishek has put out the feedback form for today's session and also a link to join our WhatsApp group, wherein we'll be sharing the links to the articles and books sir has been mentioning, and also the YouTube recordings of the sessions. So please join in to the WhatsApp group, and also you can fill in the feedback form. So we have 10 to 11 more questions and we have well past our time. So do you want to take them now, or do you want to read all of them and take it all in the evening?
See, the problem is then evening session also will get cut and get exit. So of 11, choose 5 which are most relevant for the topic which we discussed. I'll take 5 now, I'll take 5 in the evening.
Okay, so
I understand people have to do other things. I'm sorry, I'm extending this, but my apologies. Evening also, maybe our time will get extended because there will be a lot of things which you want to tie up. So let us take 5. Let me see if I can answer the first 5.
Mohammed, please ask your question.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Mohammed.
So just to put the entire discussion in perspective, a friend of mine in JNU is doing research on politics of emotion. And once he was mentioning about a German philosopher, I think it was Habermas or Nietzsche, who talks about the politics of fear. And he says that the world around us is so much competitive that we are always operating in the sense of fear. And our education system is not paying too much of attention for understanding our own our own self, you know. And this is where I want to pitch in Gandhi. I know you're not very fond of Gandhi, but even Gandhi would say this, that you try and understand yourself first, then probably you'll be able to understand, or you'll be able to handle the society out there. What are your comments on this?
One correction, I don't dislike Gandhi. I have issues with some of his ideas. Second, when you talk about self-understanding, he's almost spiritual. Even Gandhi did not really much understand the significance of emotions and feelings, whether it was Kasturba, a lot of people, he didn't really understand. So therefore, when you're talking about this whole politics of emotions, yes, there is a huge problem. And Mohammed, the problem is our education has no input at all in understanding mental health remote. Our education system is what Paulo Freire called the banking model. We have not of knowledge and we want to fill your heads with knowledge. So beyond that, we've not really had conversation discussions dealing with insecurities, dealing with fears. Okay, so therefore, that's a lot of problem. Of course, in terms of work on power and things like that, people like Foucault have done. But there's very little work integrating a lot of this work in terms of mental health, emotional well-being. So therefore, that is a huge lacuna. Okay, so that's something which we need to address. And hopefully, even if I look at B.Ed. education, there's a lot of psychology of children and things, and there's not enough on mental health of teachers. Again, in terms of, all schools and colleges may have a counselor for students. We don't have a counselor for teachers. So the mental health of teachers, mental health of other people, we don't have sufficient thing, and we don't have sufficient mental health infrastructure for schools because it costs and people don't want to pay. So therefore, there are a lot of huge issues. Because mental health is not primary. I mean, it's not central to education. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. The next question, please.
So I'm taking two questions, which are along the same lines by Priyanjali and Shikha. What is the role and necessity of external approval and acceptance? What are your thoughts on fear of failure, fear of being an embarrassment, fear of not taking the right decisions?
The first thing is that internal acknowledgement is important. External acknowledgement is something which is inevitable. We are social beings. A lot of our sense of self is defined by others. I don't know if you can find this book. It's an old book, but it's one of the first book which made me start looking at mental health for myself. It's a book called Why Am I Afraid to Tell You Who I Am? It's a book by John Powell, Powell. Now, that's the only book, more than any of Robert Fulghum, that's the only book I remember. I bought 7 copies, and all 7 copies people have flipped and not returned. So I don't know how to get them back now. I don't know whether they're still available, but that's a good book. There is another book by John Powell, which I think is reasonably good, called Will the Real Me Stand Up? His other books, some of his books are problematic, but this one book for me was very important. So when you say this fear of failure, fear of rejection, our whole life has been in terms of defined by what I call reciprocal relationships. When you're young, we're told, if you're a good boy, a good girl, you'll get this. If you do well in class, you'll get this reward. So a lot of time, this is in terms of this reward system. Okay, makes us question ourselves, and makes us we are often deprived of a lot of appreciation because we are not met expectation. That's one. The second thing is in terms of definitions of good. So a lot of them asking questions or following your own nature is often defined as not so good, and therefore over a period of time we have realized that in terms of being different is a sign of being weird or stupid or wrong. And therefore, that's something, this conditioning is something which has affected the mental health of a lot of people. So therefore, that's a serious problem in terms of that. So, but all of us need both. External acknowledgement is specific and helpful. So we need to build support groups, support individuals. Maybe whether it can come from a therapist, from a counselor, from a group, from family, from support, you figure out what is it that is relevant for you. also constantly work at questioning all the negatives about yourself. Where have they come from? Okay. And you need to let go of a lot of the past hurts and things like that, because that's what we said. Forgive yourself, forgive others for causing that hurt. Maybe it will help. But it's a slow process. It takes a lot of time. And as human beings, it's not like a switch on, off and on and off button. I can't start feeling good about myself. I need to keep working, and I can slide back because of something else which is triggered off, or experiences which are negative, or suddenly there is no support group in the horizon. So multiple things affect us. So it is definitely a slow process and continuous effort. So therefore it's difficult. Yeah.
Shweta Nayak and Anvesha Adhikari have questions along the lines of media's representation of mental health. Media mostly focuses on negative representation of mental health. There are very few stories of or coverage of positive mental health representation. How do we have more positive narratives of representation of mental health? There have been discussions around a lot of movies and TV series calling them problematic for either romanticizing some mental health issue or for misrepresenting them. To what extent can we hold media accountable? Is making such content adult 18 plus enough?
See, the first thing is I want to make a distinction between mental health and mental illness. Some movies attempt to do with mental illness. But when I say mental health in terms of emotional, psychological well-being, I don't think media has adequately even approached it. Okay, so therefore a lot of the portrayal is of disorders, illness, of extreme mental health issues, but normal mental health issues, normal mental hygiene, well-being, is not something which is addressed at all. Yes, we must hold the movies accountable, but as I said that, you know, a lot of times other than violence and things like that, things like even misogyny. If many of you can read this book called You Can't Buy My Love. Okay, You Can't Buy My Love. I forget the author, maybe I'll remember it in the evening session. You Can't Buy My Love. It's a book which is very critical of, advertising. Because it creates these issues of ideal bodies, ideal looks, which also creates a lot of problems. Second, there is a book called Business is Unusual by Anita Roddick. Anita Roddick was the founder of Body Shop. Okay. See if you can get a later edition. I used to have an earlier edition that also got flicked. In that she says 75% of women suffer from low self-esteem because their bodies don't match the ideal, the perfect thing. So when I say more than films, advertising is responsible for creating, whether it's anorexia, bulimia, a lot of those things. So You Can't Buy My Love actually documents a lot of this. It's an old book, but a very, very important book to look at what advertising media is doing, what films are doing. So all of that is, when you're talking about, like even in our country, this whole color of the skin, it's a huge problem. Products like Fair and Lovely. In terms of, to be successful, you need to use it. So all of these projections, now there's Fair and Handsome and what, so all these are severely affecting mental well-being. So when you say mental well-being in terms of feeling good about yourself, a lot of the advertising, a lot of the cinema does not help us feel good about ourselves. So for me, in this lecture, I'm not dealing with mental illness as a problem, but I'm looking at mental feeling good about ourselves. And how can we, if some of you are going to be advertisers and things like that, how can we create better communication of mental, of feeling good about ourselves? Not defined by clothes or not defined by products, but public interest communication of feeling good, of enjoying ourselves, enjoying who we are, respecting ourselves. Because even in all, see, if you look at a lot of the online communication for coronavirus to do is do this, do yoga, do sometimes just not doing anything is useful. Okay, so that's also something. And also see, even when you talk about health, I was listening to one group which I was a part of for, so where the trainer said, for your health you must eat fruits. I was just thinking, what if in today's context, otherwise a lot of poor families can't afford fruit. aren't you creating feelings of, you know, inadequacy, a lot of them that you can't afford these things. So sometimes, as I said, it basically in terms of feeling good about ourselves should not be about just activity and being productive. We need to disconnect this, our actions, not just in terms of respecting ourselves, enjoying ourselves, celebrating ourselves. We don't have anybody telling us to celebrate ourselves. And we need to find ways in which all of us can celebrate ourselves. Yeah.
No, the counseling and therapy of mental health in India is extremely expensive. How many people can actually afford that? And hence, what should we do to address this with a solution? And Mahmood has a question. Is it okay to be mentally unhealthy also?
Anyway, the first question I'll take. One, that is very true. You know, sometimes when students ask for help and I recommend them to counselor, I also wonder that in India today, counseling and things like that is only for the privileged. So those who are people of middle class and low middle class and the poor cannot really afford counseling. And therefore, in terms of mental health services as a public good and public service has to be developed. A lot of our medical education focuses so much on medicine, but mental health as well-being in terms of emotional well-being is not really a part of a lot of medicine. So that is something which is very important. I also have a problem with a lot of doctors who are even checking us for physiology. They're not even listening to us. Maybe if they listen to us, they will understand us better. And maybe they'll be able to suggest therapy, which may not need medicine. Because a lot of us want us to understand, like a lot of our illness is psychosomatic. And for psychosomatic, I don't need a psychiatrist. I need a GP who is understanding and allows me to, you know, to say it's okay. No, it's okay to feel this way. So therefore, I don't think happening in the near future, that we must have a part of education and government hospitals having a lot more spending on mental health. We are not spending anything on mental health. Okay, so therefore, it's a huge problem that that mental health does not really figure in a lot of our policy making itself. And I saw talking about mental health, I want to repeat, it's not just about illness. I'm talking about feeling good about ourselves. And about the question on is it okay to be mentally unhealthy? Anything is okay. Now, if you're comfortable feeling low and you don't want to do anything about it at the moment, it's okay. It's your choice. But if you want to have more energy, it's okay. There are sometimes when I'm just sitting down and I don't want to get up to walk or do something, or I have a problem, I consume a lot of chocolate, I love chocolate. It's okay. I indulge, it's okay. So I'm saying you need to take care of yourself. See what works for you. What is it? My only question is, what is it that makes you feel comfortable with yourself and good about yourself? Anything which helps, please do. And sometimes you want to do anything, don't want to do anything and chill for weeks, please go ahead. If it helps you, why not? Let not any external judgments decide in terms of what is good for you. You know, sometimes, you know, my problem of holiday, when I go for a holiday, my holiday is sometimes more busy because I'm visiting places, I'm doing so many things. So one former student, Anish, invited me to go to Goa for a week. And I think, of course, my problem, I love walking. But I decided not to do any sightseeing, not to visit any friends, nothing. And that I thought of health. Maybe doing nothing, chilling is important. And this coronavirus time, maybe none of us have really chilled. We're all worried, what will happen in the future? Am I doing enough? Why am I not doing this? Am I being sensitive enough? We just drown out those voices. Maybe next 2-3 days, chill. If your parents get upset, tell them, please go fight to Sudhakar. Yeah.
So we'll take this question as the last question for this session. It's by Clinton. The biggest problem is people, especially young individuals, not being in control of their senses. The outer factors control our perceptions, our thoughts, our understanding of what is right and wrong, how one should stay in a society. Individuals try to fit in based on those perceptions and then submit to it based on what they see, which is nothing but illusion. When one is not able to fit in, one feels disappointed and stressed. How can young individuals take control of their senses?
See, the first thing, yes, it's a very difficult thing because so many of us who are different, okay, are often forced to conform because if you want to be accepted. And sometimes we are not accepted for many things, right from our skin color to the way our bodies are built and whatever else. So therefore, that causes a lot of damage. There is a very interesting book called Transformation Soup. In one of the conversations, she said, one young girl tells her, the ways in which you are different is succulent, not weird. So in terms of, that is something we need to find ways in which people can celebrate ourselves. So the question which you asked is very true, that in terms of a lot of people are given to addictions and various kinds of things, often because of a sense of alienation, of a sense of wanting to belong to a cool group. So there's a lot of things. So therefore, we will need to educate families, school teachers and everybody to devote a little time to making everybody kind of being okay in being different. And not set standards, very strong standards, which some people for many reasons may not be able to match up to. So if you look at schools like J. Krishnamurti Foundation schools, they don't have exams at the 8th standard, because that then means there's no competition, no comparison. And of course, they feel if people have to go into the mainstream, so after 8th, they have an examination. I talked about Summer Hill, please read that. That's also something where they decide to have a non-competitive. So we need to create maybe more situations where we are less judgmental about people, where expectations are toned down. A lot of this will have to happen, and maybe it may not happen because of the constant pressure all of us are in. But if you're aware, and if you can create again online groups like these, which can have more conversations, maybe it's a good idea. I don't know whether I answered the question. This is my response at the moment. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. The rest of the questions, which are just two, will rest in the evening session. If you have any other question, you can put it on the feedback form. We have a section for that too. Please fill in the feedback form. It helps us to improve the quality of the sessions in any way we can. And do join in the WhatsApp group for further updates. And in the evening at 6:30 p.m., we have the last session for this lecture series. So looking forward to have you all there. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Shruti. Thank you all. A big thank you to all of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.